visible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So even some of you can help me fill it. So if you look at this node 1 here, it is adjacent to node 4 and 6. So my first entry is going to be 4 and second is 6. So this 4 and 6, these both numbers, they are present in a linked list. So this entry here, the node 1, it holds a pointer to the head of this linked list. And the first node of this linked list have a value 4. The second node has a value 6. 6 can rather than be pointing to null. I'm just writing it this way here. So the next of 6 is null. So I see many of you actually completing it very quickly. Very nice. So this shows me that you have understood it. So 5 is linked to 2 and 7. 6 is linked to 1. 4 is linked to 2 and 3. Perfect. 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 Very nice. Unfortunately, I can't see who is typing, so I see the anonymous entries, but very nice. Right, so I hope it is clear now. Okay. What I'll do now is I'll move forward. So in the last lecture, we were discussing about isomorphism. I think graph representations are now clear to all of you. I'll just go back. Okay. I hope you can see my slides. So rather, I've shared these slides with you also. I'm on this 11th slide. So we were discussing about graph isomorphism in the last class, and I posed this question to you. Do you think that both of these graphs are isomorphic? And someone even answered it. Have you all tried this question? Anyone? So now I think we are back to the lecture mode, and I request all of you to switch on your video so that we are in a discussion mode. Okay, so anyone, do you think that these graphs are isomorphic? Can you show me a mapping? Okay, so here I'm going to help you. Maybe because of Diwali holidays, we are not on the track. So here I'm showing you this graph here, right? This graph over here. What I have to do now, I just have to change the vertices of this node here and there. So I'm going to move these vertices in this space in such a way that I get the graph on the right-hand side. So can you help me with this movement? Do you think I can change the positions of these vertices in such a way that I see the graph on the right hand side? No. Will be helpful if you unmute and speak. Will be difficult for me to look at the chat window.
Hello, ma'am.
Okay, so here I'm going to do it for you. So let's say I just take this vertex A and I put it over here. I move B here and C here. This one is actually pretty straightforward, D here, right? So I get this first square as I see in my figure. Then this E is connected to A here, F is connected to B here, right? And I think I have got the same structure as you see in the second graph. So rather, you can do a whole lot of things with this graph. You can move around these vertices, and every time you'll find a graph that looks different, but that's actually the same. So I can even do, I can convert it into a cube form of a structure. I can do something like this here. Being a bit difficult for me, maybe you can try. So yeah, right? So now it looks like a cube. So all these graphs are actually the same, but only the labeling of the vertices is different. So whenever we talk about isomorphic graph, they are nothing but actually the same graphs. So if you look at all these three graphs here on this slide, all of these three graphs are actually the same. So it's like just a chameleon which changes its color. Okay, so now I'm going to ask you a question which is based on what you have studied previously. So I show you a graph here. So this is a graph which you see on this slide, and then you see a set here. Can you tell me what this set is?
The number of edges of a vertex.
Yes. For so every we vertex. Call that the degree, or you say the number of incident edges on a vertex, right? So it's the degree of each vertex. So A is connected to three other nodes, B is connected to three other nodes. So we have written all these numbers here. So whenever you do this for any graph, we call it a degree sequence. And rather, many a times it's better to write it in a non increasing order or a descending order, or you can even write it in an ascending order, right? So such a sequence is called a degree sequence. Okay. Now I'm telling you, whenever I'm going to write a degree sequence, I'm going to write it in a descending order. So in this case, all these degrees are equal. So I have written all these threes here. Okay, now can you tell me if I do this mapping on the left hand side, I have all the graphs. So I have a set A. This set A has all the graphs as you see on the left hand side. And on the right hand side, I have a set B, which has all the possible degree sequences. Do you think this mapping is a function? Take some time to think and then answer. If the what I'm asking is not clear to you, I can explain it again.
Yes, ma'am, it's a function.
It's a function. Why do you say that?
You have like one like basis of input and like one basis of output.
Okay. So what are the two main properties of a function?
For any one input, you have one output, but like not the other way around.
Is it clear to everyone? So you can discuss with each other. This classroom is open for discussions. One of your friend is asking if any of you has any doubts, you can even channel it to him and he will reply to your queries. Is it clear why this is a function?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so to Rishabh also this is clear. So whenever we talk about functions on the left hand side, we have a domain and we have a range. On the left hand side we have domain and on the right hand side we have a range. So what should happen? Every element in this domain should be mapped to exactly one element in the range. So here if we look at any graph, so since I'm writing this degree sequence in a descending order, a graph will have exactly one degree sequence. So it's not possible that a graph doesn't have a degree sequence or has more than one degree sequence. So hence in this case, it's a function. Okay. Is this function invertible? Now a slightly tricky question. So think about it and answer it. So I hope you know what are invertible functions. If not, you can discuss it with me. Think about it and answer it. Do you think this function is invertible? So you know. So I'm going to stop sharing the screen from here. Jayant says this function is not invertible. Will someone else try to answer why, or try to validate it? Why it's not,
it is not invertible?
I'd say it is invertible.
I think it's not invertible.
Okay, Rishabh also says it's not invertible. It's not
not invertible.
Can you give me reason why it's not invertible?
Ma'am, because for it to be invertible, it should be 1-1 relation too.
It should be 1-1 relation, okay.
But the all the edges, like the corresponding value is 3 only. And according to 1-1 relation, then edges A and B should also be same if the corresponding were 3 and B.
Okay, any more answers?
Ma'am, I'd say it is invertible because even though you have like the same number in all of the spaces, each of the spaces is still like a unique space. It's like a multi, it's like a multi-variable, multi-dimensional like output. So therefore, you can map it back to another.
Every like, degree graph. Sequence will have a graph. Okay. And every graph will have a degree sequence. So it has to be
invertible. So it has to be invertible, I'm saying.
Okay. So now I hear this statement. Just give me a second. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So I hear this statement now. Every graph will have a degree sequence and every degree sequence will have a corresponding graph. What do you think about this statement?
Every degree sequence can have multiple graphs.
But they are, shouldn't they all be polymorphs?
But
all the multiple graphs might, won't they be polymorphs of each other?
Can you come again?
Like every say we have a certain degree
all
sequence.
All the graphs that are being made by that one degree
sequence. By that degree sequence, they should be polymorphs.
Okay.
Isomorphic, yes, sir.
Isomorphic.
Okay. Isomorphic,
okay.
Yeah, sorry, wrong word.
Okay, yeah, that actually makes sense now. Okay.
Okay, so we have two questions now. Let's answer them one by one. So first question is, will every degree sequence have a graph? So given to me a degree sequence, so let's say I give you some degree sequence, can you always make a graph out of it? This is the first question. Second is, given to you a degree sequence, can you make two graphs out of it, right? And definitely they should be non-isomorphic graphs because you can make any number of isomorphic graphs. So given to your degree sequence, can you make two graphs which are definitely non-isomorphic? Okay. Let's look into this. Here I give you a degree sequence, 3, 2, 1. Can you make a graph out of this degree sequence?
Yeah.
You can try making one. Rather, you can just look at it and answer. By looking at these numbers here, you can directly answer it.
I may change my answer. I don't think they have to be invertible.
Okay.
Because if you take a degree sequence such as 1, 1, 1, 2, 1.
1, 1.
1, 2, 1.
Or 1, 2, 1.
Something of that nature. Then. Okay. The position of the node or vertex with two edges can be moved around. You get multiple graphs which are not isomorphic in that case.
Okay. So Abhinav observes here, actually out of one degree sequence, you can make two graphs which are not isomorphic. That's the first thing. Okay, let's look at this sequence here, 3, 2, 1. Can you give me a solid reason why you cannot make a graph out of it? Can someone try and make a graph out of it? So I want one vertex which has a degree 3. Right? And then I have a vertex which has a degree 2. So let me make it this way. So this one has a degree 3. This one has a degree 2. This one has a degree 1. But something goes wrong. I have one more vertex here which has a degree 1.
Ma'am, the sum had to be a power of 2 power n, right?
Sum need to be a power of?
We in the starting we saw that if we sum the degree up of a graph, then
yes.
it had to be a power of 2 power n.
So we studied in the last lecture that the sum of degrees is an even number. So if you add all these degrees, d1 plus d2, it is 2 times your number of edges. Right? So here the sum of degrees is 6.
Yeah, it's even.
But do you see here? Okay. What can be the maximum possible degree of a graph, any vertex in a graph? If I have a graph on 10 nodes.
The number of nodes.
Is it the number of nodes? Minus one, right? And you see here, what is this? Three. So this graph here, it's having three vertices. So is it possible that a vertex has a degree three? So I have three vertices here. Now, if I want to give this vertex a degree of three, it can have a maximum degree of two. So given this degree sequence, we cannot make a graph out of it. Okay. What about this degree sequence?
No, ma'am.
No, right? This you can directly answer. So add up all these degrees, 2 plus 2, 4, 4 plus 3, 7. It's an odd number. Please notice that here in all these cases, we are talking about simple graphs only. Okay, what about this one? Where it went? I'm sorry. Okay. Can you draw a graph having this degree sequence? Can someone just try and give us a graph having this degree sequence?
Five nodes.
Sorry?
No, no.
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Can you help me?
Yes, ma'am.
So let me take some five vertices here. Right? So any one of these vertices have a degree three. So let me just connect it to three vertices. If someone has figured out what the graph is, can you help me drawing this graph here?
Ma'am, connect 4 to 5.
Okay, I connect 4 to 5.
Then 4 has two.
4 has?
Edges, two edges.
Okay, 4 has a degree of 2 here.
And 2, 3, 5 has degree of 1.
Okay, so I'm done. So this has a degree 1 here, this has a degree 1 here, this has a degree 1 here, this has a degree 3 here. Okay, so we are done. So given this degree sequence, I can make a graph out of it. Okay. I'll come back to this question again. Let's come back to our original question. So we're discussing about whether this function is invertible or not. So we have seen one thing. So definitely this function is not invertible. We have seen that given a degree sequence, it's not always possible that you can draw a graph out of it. The second point, given a degree sequence, can you have more than one graphs? So for that, I'm going to show you an example here. Somewhere, just give me a second. Seems like I have misplaced it somewhere. Someone was giving me an example. Can you help me out? So I'm unable to search for my example. Someone was giving me an example that given a degree sequence, we can have two graphs. Can you help me making one?
Could you repeat the question?
The question is, given to you a degree sequence, can you show me that there are two possible graphs, or rather more than one graph you can draw out of it?
Ma'am, I had a question.
Yes, please tell me.
When you say invertible, when we use numbers, it makes sense. Like if one maps to two, then two should map to one. But as a graph, what do you mean when you say it's invertible?
Okay, let me just clarify this. So let me take this example. So what we mean by when we say that something, that a function is not invertible. So I'm taking a very, very simple example. So I'm going to have a function and we call this function location. So let's say on in my domain, I have all the people who are present on Earth. So I have person one, person two, and there are a whole lot of person, billions. And in the range, I have all the locations which are there on Earth. So you can think about every possible location. You can have some cities, some states, you can have deep under oceans, or you can have, let's say, the hills here or the places where nobody lives. So all those places are going to be here, right? So now this is clearly a function, right? Because every person definitely will be at exactly one of the places. If a person is alive, he has to be at some place, and a person cannot be at two places at a time. So this is a function. When we say that this function is invertible, when will this function be invertible? I'm just going to swap both of these. So I'm going to write it down as, so the places come this side. So I'm going to make my places the domain, and I'm going to make my person, so the people, the range. And then I'll see, do both the things hold still? If it has to hold, then corresponding to each place, you should have a person. This means you pick any place on this earth, there should be one person which is present at that place, which is not true, right? So this is not invertible. And your, what was your second property? Given a place, there should be only one person, but there can be more than one people at one place, right? So it can be mapped to multiple elements here. So in this case, this function is not invertible. When will this function be invertible? So you should notice that for a function to be invertible, what are the properties? You must have a
one function.
It should be a
bijective.
One function as well as
onto,
right? So definitely you should not have any places here which are empty if you want this function to be invertible. Because otherwise, when you will invert it, there will be these places in the domain which will have no mapping entry here, right? And secondly, this should not happen. So in this direction, it is possible when it is a function. Two people can be at the same place, right? But for it to be invertible, now when again you will make these places the domain, this element will start mapping to two elements or two people here, right? So this is what is a invertible function. Is it clear? So the same thing is what is happening between your graph and the degree sequence. So so the graph are like the people here, and your degree sequence are like the places here. So if I have a graph, I'm going to have exactly one degree sequence corresponding to this graph here. And yeah, yes, I wanted to show you an example. I'll show it to you at the end of the class, because I'll need to switch between my systems. So actually, it is very much possible that you have a degree sequence here, and corresponding to that degree sequence, you can have two graphs. So it is very much possible that two graphs which are not isomorphic have the same degree sequence. Okay. Now we'll quickly discuss about an algorithm. Assume that I give you a degree sequence. Let's say it's a graph on some 100 nodes, and I give you a degree sequence which is having 100 numbers. And I want you to tell me whether there is a graph corresponding to this degree sequence or not. Can you come up with an algorithm for that? So there is this very beautiful algorithm. This is called the Hewlett-Hakimi algorithm, which you can use to actually tell, can you always, given to you a degree sequence, is there a graph corresponding to it or not? And this is pretty straightforward. So what I'm going to do is, so just look at this procedure here I'm following. So I'm given this degree sequence here. I'll try to make a graph corresponding to it. So how I'm going to do is, I'll arrange it in an descending order. So currently it's arranged in a descending order. I say that this is my sequence number one, right? And I'm going to have these six vertices in my graph. So I have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, right? So let's say I want my vertex 1 to have a degree 4, vertex 2 to have a degree 4, vertex 3 to have a degree 3, vertex 4 have degree 1. So I want the degrees to be like this. Now, for vertex 1, I want a degree 4. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to connect it to four other vertices. But which four? So in order to see which four, I'm always going to go one by one. So I'm going to connect it with vertex 2 first, then vertex 3, then vertex 4, and then vertex 5. I connect it to these four vertices. So vertex 1, I connect it to vertex 2, vertex 3, vertex 4, and vertex 5. So I have accomplished this degree from my degree sequence. Now what is remaining? Vertex 2, now it needs three more edges, right? One it has got from vertex 1, vertex 3 needs two more, vertex 4, 0 completed, vertex 5, 0 completed, vertex 6 still needs one. So what I'm going to do now, I'm again going to arrange it in a descending order. So now my sequence 2 will be vertex 1, I am done. So I have vertex 2, vertex 3, and vertex 6. And I'm again going to arrange. So this is in the descending order, right? Perfect. So now vertex 2, it has a pending degree of 3. So vertex 2, did I miss something here? No, right? So vertex 2, now if you look at vertex 2, I want to give it a degree of 3. So I can connect it to vertex 3, vertex 6, but there is no other vertex I can connect it now, right? So it means that you actually cannot make a graph out of this degree sequence. You can even apply this same procedure to this graph here. So let's quickly do it. So this is a degree sequence, which is actually possible. So one of you has told me this, so I'm just going to rub it. I'm again going to apply that same algorithm here. So I have a vertex 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then let's say V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. Arrange in a descending order as of now. For vertex 1, I want to give it a degree of 3. Let me connect vertex 1 to vertex 2, vertex 3, and vertex 4. So this one is done. Now what is remaining? For vertex 2, 1, vertex 3, done. Vertex 4 is also done. Vertex 5, 1. And again you arrange them in a descending order. So what will be your S1? So for S1, I'll have vertex 2 first, which requires degree 1, vertex 5, which requires degree 1. Vertex 1, I have connected it. Vertex 3 is also connected. Vertex 4 is also connected. Now, I need to connect vertex 2 with vertex 5. We connect vertex 2 here with vertex 5. And you are done. So all these sequences out of which you can actually make a graph, we call them graphical sequences. And those sequences which cannot be converted into a graph, we call them the non-graphical sequences. Now, if you carefully look at this procedure, you even need not draw this graph at all here. So you can just look at this sequence. You can keep on redistributing it. Like these are some balls here and you can do it. So I need not every time make a graph. So whenever I see a sequence like this, 1, 1, 1, I know that I can take this 4 away. How can I take this 4 away? By reducing 1 from each. So I need not actually draw this graph here. You can work right away with this sequence here. So this 4 needs to be distributed. So it takes away one from here, one from here. So now what is pending with me is 3, 2, 1, 0, 0, 0. Now again, this 3 can distribute itself. So it takes 1 from here, 0 from here, but now all are zeros. So there is nothing more it can take from the numbers over here. So you can again declare that this is a non-graphical sequence. So this is a very famous algorithm to do this. I'm not going into the correctness of this algorithm. So whenever you give an algorithm like this, it is sort of a greedy algorithm and you need to prove that this algorithm actually works. So we are not going in there. If there is any doubt till here in this, you can ask me if there is some doubt in this algorithm. So in the next lecture, we will start with a small quiz based on this algorithm we just discussed and the videos I asked you to look into. And after that, we'll start with our class. So if you have any doubts from today's class, you can ask me. Any doubts? So you can even skim through the slides. I have given you the link to the slides. You can skim through those slides one and ask me if there is any doubt. Any doubt, anyone? Okay, so one thing before leaving, I'll just show you the graph I was talking about. So how corresponding to 1 degree sequence, you can have two graphs. Actually, you can go to the slides I have shared with you. So if you go Chaitanya, I have shared the link to the slides. I'll share it once again. So all of you can just move to the slide number 20 and see those graphs for yourself. So there are two graphs. If you look at those two graphs, they have the same degree sequence, but you can figure out that the graphs are not isomorphic. Give me a second. I'll share the link with you. So we can move to slide number 20 and look at the graph. If you have any doubts, you can ask. If you have no doubts, you can leave.
Ma'am, could you explain the edge list once again?
What you do in edge list, you simply list all the edges which are there in your graph. See, the problem is if you are having a very sparse network, let's say I give you a graph on 100 nodes, right? And there is only one edge in this graph. So I'm taking an extreme example. So if you draw the adjacency matrix, it will be a 100 cross 100 matrix and you'll have a one somewhere in that matrix, right? So what you do in an edge list representation, you just list that edge. You just tell the user that there is an edge from graph 3 to graph 4. Just give me a moment. I'll show you. I'll actually show you what is an edge list representation. Just give me a second. So most of the time when you look at these graphs, so I'm actually going to show you a real world data set. So let's say I'm going to show you a data set for a Facebook graph. Look at this graph here. So this is a graph on 4,039 nodes, which is having around 88,000 edges. And this is the information about your graph. So if you look at this representation here, Can you look at it, how this representation is? So it simply tells you that there is an edge from node 0 to node 1. There is an edge from node 0 to node 2, node 0 to node 3, so on and so forth. So it lists almost all the 88,000 edges in this graph. So this is your edge list representation. So here it has taken a space of 88,000. But what if you would do it with the help of an adjacency matrix? There are around 4,050 nodes. So it will be 4,050 into, again, almost around 4,050, which is a big number. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Welcome, Nika. Any other doubts?